Listening Library presents Jack Plank Tells Tales by Natalie Babbitt. Read for you by John H. Mayer. A note to the reader. It really doesn't matter, but in case you're interested, Jack Plank is telling these tales on the island of Jamaica in the Caribbean Sea around the year 1720. There'd been a lot of pirates in those waters ever since Christopher Columbus came over from Spain looking for India. India wasn't there, but Columbus did find a lot of islands with a lot of treasure. Gold and silver and other nice things. That was very good news to the Spanish king and queen, who sent ships right away to start removing it from the natives it belonged to and bringing it back to Spain. This made things easy for the pirates. They let Spain do the removing, so that later on they could run down the Spanish ships and grab the lot. After about 200 years, though, things weren't quite so easy for pirates. There are a lot of reasons why this was so, but never mind. It's just that Jack probably got out of the business at the right time. Chapter 1. How It All Began. Jack Plank was an out-of-work pirate. He'd had a job, and a good job, too, on a lovely ship called the Avarice. But the thing is, Jack wasn't good at plundering. There's only one way to plunder. You have to yell and make faces and rattle your sword. And once you've got people scared, you take things away from them. That's what pirates do. But Jack didn't seem to have a knack for it. Still, he was used to the life of the open sea, and he was fond of his shipmates, all of whom were just as fond of him, including the quartermaster Leech, who mostly hated everyone. Even Captain Scudder was fond of him. So he kept his place for a good long time. After a while, though, Captain Scudder told him to stay behind and keep the soup hot while the others were busy plundering, and then in the evenings they'd all have supper together and go to sleep happy. But a hard day came when pirating didn't pay as well as sometimes, and there wasn't always soup enough for everyone. So the captain said to Jack, "Plank, old man, hard days do not allow for sentiment, like it or not. We're going to have to let you go, for we can't afford to feed any but the plunderers." And of course, Jack could see the sense of this, even if it was a disappointment. Later that same night, with the Avarice anchored well offshore from an island port called Saltwash, the crew lowered a longboat, and a bunch of them, including the quartermaster Leech, rowed Jack into shore. Jack and his little trunk of keepsakes. "We'll miss you, Jack," said Leech, holding his voice low so as not to rouse the Saltwash population. "Here's a goodbye present. We all put in a piece." And Leech handed him a small bag of money. Gold florins enough, they hoped, to start him in some new direction. They patted him on the back and shoved off in the longboat, leaving him behind. Poor Jack watched them go till they'd reached the Avarice and boarded her, and he watched as she slipped away, silent as a shadow in the moonlight. Away and away, till there was nothing left to watch except the lift of the waves and now and then a far-off shooting star. "Well, that's it, I guess," said Jack. But he didn't give in to feeling sorry for himself. Instead, he wrapped up warm in his cloak, stretched out right there on the beach, and managed to go to sleep. And in the morning, with a bright sun climbing the sky to cheer him, he brushed the sand off his clothes, picked up his little trunk, and with his florins in his pocket, made his way into town. The deepest part of the Saltwash Harbor was crowded with docks, ships, and sailors, but Jack didn't pause to watch them working. Instead, he walked about, up and down the streets, looking for a place to live, and settled at last on a boarding house that was narrow but tall and had a window box with bright red flowers and a sign above the flowers that said, "Rooms to let by the week, by the month. Mrs. DelFresno, proprietress. Ring bell." Jack stepped forward, set down his trunk, and rang the bell. And here came Mrs. DelFresno herself, opening the door to him, a handsome widow, plump and neatly dressed. And she looked him in the eye and said severely, "Yes?" Jack bowed to the widow, hat in hand, and introduced himself, explaining that he wished to take a room. "Well, sir," said Mrs. DelFresno, "that's as may be, but it's plain to see you're a pirate, so I'm not entirely sure you'll do." "I was a pirate once," said Jack, "that's true, but I've put the life aside, if not the uniform. King George across the sea in England is pardoning all of us who give it up. But now I must try a new career, with a nice place to live while I'm trying." "Ah," said Mrs. DelFresno, "that's different then. Still, I hardly know." Then here came her daughter, Nina, sharp and smart and 11 years old, and she studied Jack from the doorway. "I like him, Mama," she said at last to her mother. "Let's take him in." "Well, perhaps," said Mrs. DelFresno, frowning at Jack. "But tell me, Mr. Plank, how will you get along with my other boarders, old Miss Withers and her uncle? They've been here now for many months, and I must consider their welfare."
"Consider away," said Jack, "and I'll consider with you. That's only fair, but I like the company of others, ma'am, and always did. There won't be any problems. That I promise."
At this, Mrs. DelFresno made up her mind. "Very well, Mr. Plank," she said. "We'll try you out, and if in a week or so you've found steady work and proved yourself fit, you may stay as long as you wish. 1 gold florin a day, please, and supper is at 7.
And Nina said, "I'll help you find the perfect job, Mr. Plank. I can show you around and introduce you, for everyone knows Mama here in Saltwash, and just as many know me."
"My dear," said Jack, "you are very, very kind." So they all shook hands, the widow and Nina and Jack, and Jack was introduced to old Miss Withers and her uncle, and they all shook hands again. Then Jack moved into a pleasant room at the top of the house, where there was one big window looking out to the open sea. And that's how his new life began. Chapter 2. Not a Farmer. The next day, at supper time, Mrs. DelFresno said to Jack,
"How did things go with Nina today, Mr. Plank? Did you find suitable work?"
"No, I'm sorry to say I didn't," he told her. "Miss Nina thought I might enjoy the sugar cane fields, and so indeed I might, but there was a problem with the bridge."
"What bridge?"
asked the uncle of old Miss Withers, looking up from his supper.
"The bridge that goes over the river to the cane fields," said Nina. "Mr. Plank didn't want to cross it."
"Very sensible," said old Miss Withers, stabbing the air with her fork. "Bridges are always on the edge of falling down."
"Perhaps you're right, ma'am," said Jack. "But you see, I don't use bridges, good or bad."
"What? Never?" said Mrs. DelFresno.
"Well, not if I don't have to," said Jack. "The thing is, when I was new to pirating, we had a mate on board the Avarice called Lugger, who knew a thing or two about bridges. I learned a lot from him."
"What is there to learn about bridges?"
said the uncle of old Miss Withers.
"Except they keep your feet dry."
"Tell them what you told me, Mr. Plank,"
said Nina. But my dear...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.